car.
Riders ready, watch the gate.
This is BMX bicycle racing. It's basically an acceleration contest. It's not endurance. And so the whole thing is, it's like car drag racing. In other words, get going really fast, hold the lead, and then carry it on through to the end. So what you do is you get three opportunities to advance. They're called motos. Moto 1, Moto 2, Moto 3. Some other organizations have different rules, but I'm talking about ABA, American Bicycle Association. You have eight lanes on a track, and to advance into the next round, you had to win one of the motos. Okay, that means, so you get into the first moto, and usually a very good rider would win it. He or she would sit down, and then this other seven riders would go into the second moto, then whoever won that would sit down, then there'd be a third moto for the third rider. Then those three riders would advance into the next level of competition. At a big meet, it could be eighth finals, quarterfinals, semifinals, but you advanced, okay? So the big issue is to get out of the first round. It's like in basketball, getting past the first round of the playoffs. Well, there's eight riders, and so you have eight lanes. And lane eight is always called the one that is farthest from where you turn. So if you turn left, this would be lane eight. If you turn right, this would be lane eight.
To the outside lane.
It's the outside lane. You have to travel furthest. If all riders were equally talented, you wouldn't win out of lane eight. I mean, if they all fell down, or if something happened, somebody nearly... But in general, assuming that all riders are equally talented, the chances of winning out of lane 8 are very slim.
A lot of people watching might have seen the Olympic Games or running races where we see staggered lanes, or we could have a tilted start line, like an angled start line. Yeah. BMX racing doesn't compensate in this way?
No, if you could keep people in their lanes, you know, like you do in track, you say you have to stay for the first lap in your lane. But of course you don't. And what happens, if you ever try to do that, these really aggressive riders, okay, would just, in other words, if somebody was in front and they saw somebody starting to pass them, they would just move in front of them and knock them down. So you can't give someone an opportunity to be in front of somebody else because they'll move it out and it's gone. So that doesn't work. Years and years ago when my son started racing, everybody just rushed the gate and just, now notice that lane eight outside is no good and lane one inside, it's too easy to get so somebody to cut you off or somebody to get boxed in. So the good lanes are usually 2, 3, 4, maybe in an extreme case 5, but let's say 3 and 4. In the early days, people would rush to the track when they said, let's start the racing, and they'd run and get into 3 or 4. So then they said, no, that's not fair. So then they decided, okay, what we're gonna do is we're gonna call these lanes at random. Sometimes you'd have a deck of cards, okay, and they'd have eight, and you just pull the card, and that was your lane. Or they have an urn with balls in it and you pull one and stuff. And at least that was fair in the sense that, you know, you had equally likely chance to get any one of the lanes. So that's how it went on for years and years and years at the start of each moto. Remember, we have three motos. So you have a random draw to start of moto 1, random draw to start of moto 2, random draw to start of moto 3. Now the problem was that with that random draw, there's a reasonably likely chance that you could pull 3/8. And if you were off somewhere, like my son once was, we were in Shreveport, Louisiana, and he pulled 3/8. Well, he rode gallantly, okay, but he still didn't qualify into the next round. Okay?
So he was unlucky.
The curse of lane eight. The curse of lane eight. So I said, we need a better system. We need one where my son can't get 3/8 or 2/8 and a 7. A colleague of mine who's a statistician, we just started talking and said, let's fix this. Okay, we're mathematicians, we're hotshots. Let's fix this system. There were two breakthroughs. Okay, two breakthroughs. The first breakthrough was, let's not assign a lane independently three times. Let's instead give you a triple, and your triple would have three numbers. And for example, let's say it had 1, 5, 8. That means you get lane 1 in the first moto, lane 5 in the second, and 8 in the third. And here was another major breakthrough. Instead of working mathematically with the numbers of the lanes, like 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, we decided to work with the priorities, okay? 1 meant the best lane, 2 meant the second best, and 8 meant the worst. That has mathematical content. So we put mathematical meaning into it by saying priorities. They're well ordered, they're numbered. There's a one, it means something. An eight, it means something. Those two breakthroughs, triples and priorities. That's kind of subjective. So what you do is you ask a bunch of good riders, which one is their most desirable? And there's almost total agreement. Almost, if you had to say anything, it'd almost always be lane three. Sometimes a four, okay, maybe. But it was almost the same. Which was the worst? Everybody would say eight. So maybe there's some fuzziness in between, but almost all the good riders would tell you the same thing. So that was not a problem.
So did you do this? Was there some kind of survey or poll?
Yeah, I did. Every time I did it with my son and his friends. And they thought that sometimes there was a right answer and a wrong answer. Of course there wasn't. So now I had to build a mathematical model that says, how am I going to come up with the very best set of eight triples that will be the fairest, and then run it on the computer with an algorithm to give us the best. So we did. And what we did is we tried to say, look, everybody should have the same. You know, if you summed up priorities, like maybe the priorities were like 1, 5, 8, as I said before, and you summed them, you're gonna get 14. Well, maybe everybody should have the same sum of priorities. That would be a good fairness criteria. But you can't do that. They're all gonna be 13 or 14. So now you start playing mathematical games about saying a model. So soon you start to realize that the best solution is gonna have 4 13s and 4 14s. So that's already cutting the data back a lot, you see? It's already saying, oh, now I don't have to search everything. And so with that constraint that 4 are going to be 13 and 4 are going to be 14, you start to do a search. Out comes a situation where you get these optimal 8 triples. In less than 1 second, we found 7,000 solutions, okay? So yeah. But that's too many solutions. So...
Well, doesn't that mean that's great? You could just choose...
No. Look, you say good things, but look, in mathematics and physics, when you find too many solutions, that means you didn't put enough information into your mathematical model. The most beautiful mathematics is there exists one solution, see? And that's why in life we say, there's one perfect marriage partner. There's one perfect house. There's one perfect, which I'll grant you that there's not. But anyway, we like that. So I spent time with a student and we said, look, if you're an average rider, the third motor is more important than the first and the second. And I'm going to tell you why. Because there's always some hot shot. And this hot shot is going to ruin the first race. Then the second hot shot will win the second.
So they're not in the third race.
They're not in the third race. So now you want to optimize your chances in the third race.
That's when you want the prime.
That's when you want the prime lane. So I said, let's weight these sums so that they're not all equal. And that a good lane in the third moto is worth more than a good lane in the first. And we put a little tiny bit of weighting on there, and very simple. I mean, like, the weighting was that maybe in the third moto there's only 6 riders, so we weighted it by maybe 8/6 or something. That gave us a unique solution. So we ended up with our optimal solution. I say any reasonable mathematician or intelligent person, once you told them, look, think of priorities and think of triples, they'd come up with our system. That's what I say.
Professor, the only problem I see with your system is the priorities are very subjective, and Billy the BMXer might prefer lane one because he's good on tight corners, and Sally might like the outside lane because she doesn't like crashes, and like different riders might have different priorities and not like your bowl system.
I mean, of course you're right, but you're really fine-tuning at a level that doesn't exist, okay? I mean, the bulk of the riders, so there's somebody who has some particularly, well, they're gonna lose, they're gonna pay a price, okay? But you're doing this for the bulk of the things. And granted, there's always going to be some kind of a criticism like that, okay? And indeed, you can say that. But it's not a concern, okay? And if you say we're going to do this for the bulk of the riders, it's going to take care of bulk of the problems. In a certain sense, I wasn't trying to save the world. I was trying to use mathematics in something that would improve the quality of my local life while my son was racing, okay? And we did that. And so to me, it was a validation of mathematics, okay? How people, mathematics is not useful. Well, mathematical thinking and the mathematics allowed me to do something very interesting.